Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Tim, the Wandering Hannon, with Ben, Home-Cooked Fowler, and Ryan, Bayou Boy Sawoski. Will, the homeless Heim, is not here. We assume he is well, and we wish him the best, as he did not wake up time for the podcast. Yes.
He's dead.
Pretty sure he's just dead asleep. Yes. When Will sleeps, he sleeps hard. Like, we can message him.
We wish him
I've called him before. He did not wake up. So.
Will's we wish him the happiest of dreams.
Do we? I should probably just text Daisy. His cat will wake him up. But.
Yes.
This week on the 106th episode of the STABcast, Battle Reports from Sci-Fi City. I have no excuses here, people. I've played a game this week and some fun mail calls.
There you go. Look at you go.
You go, Glen Coco. It's all you.
So I was going to start the section off with Will, alert the men. Their captain has played a game. But Will's not here.
Those men will not be alert.
If anyone was going to be a kiff in our podcast, it was going to be Will.
That's also very true. Yeah.
I speak the true. So I have been, you know, slammed with work and things. And, you know, I had a Saturday come free. I was at a good place as far as schoolwork was going for my actual doctorate. I felt comfortable going out to a store I've not been to, the Iron Wyvern.
Yeah.
Which is just like 30 minutes south of Knoxville. So nice little area, kind of suburban, but rural and fun. And the store itself is fantastic.
Fantastic.
The city is one of those old school, like downtown southern places. So it was, you know, 15 buildings kind of wrapped up in a row, nice little streets. And it's got a great play space. I'll be real honest. It's got food. It's got drink. It's got a little place that will actually make you Chinese food from a guy that lived there for 10 years. Wow. A fantastic place upstairs. Like, I was really impressed with it, Tim. Yeah, like, I'm kind of sad you moved away from it.
I know. I'm sad I'm going to miss that now. Yeah.
It was actually really, really cool.
Yeah. We linked up with their game group. They've existed near us, but just never really reached out. And I found out that their play day was Saturday. And so I tried to rustle some people together, and we went and hung out. And it was a good time.
A lot of people who are still kind of in the process of painting some armies.
Yep.
So a lot of planned future expansion. So
that's cool.
I got to play. He's local. He's local to there, but he's come to Knoxville to play quite a bit.
Yeah, he's played with us in the past. Absolutely, yeah.
He's played with us in the past. Yeah. So I haven't played David in ages. COVID, of course, my schedule. In fact, the last time I did play him, I was running a full Weiss AT-ST Imperial list.
Oh, wow.
That's a long time ago.
Yeah. That's how long ago that was. Is that? Yeah. And it was a fantastic memory. And I just, because my AT-ST had an HQ uplink and it was just running across the field. Like, it's not near enough to get an order. I would just use the HQ uplink, fire all the shots, and then just refresh when I needed to. Or just wait for it to come out of the bag because it's an AT-ST. And so, like, it's charging across the table. It's in his zone. I'm shooting everything. It was a fantastic memory of mine. Love that. Love that game. Anyhow, so yeah, I was running whatever I had put in my bag last. So that was what I last played against him, I think, in my own home.
Oh, yes.
So that is Grievous, a T-Series, 6B1s, 4 with E5s, 2 of them with rockets, and double Magnas, also with rockets.
Because why not?
David is branching out. He kind of got out of Legion for a little bit because of COVID and some things, and he has to get back in. So he was playing with his clone army, Yoda, Chewbacca, Wookiee Madness, you know, all the Wooks he could fit back in there, and of course the required 3P1 core.
I dig it. Okay. It's a good list. It is a rough list if you're like just coming back to Legion. Like, there's a lot of triggers and a lot of synergies to keep an eye on and to really make that list do what it needs to do.
Exactly. And it's one of those, like, it has a lot of health. It does. It has low activation count.
Yeah.
And so when I'm running 10 activations with the things that I've got,
yep,
it makes it a little bit hard. Like, it is. And again, I didn't list plan. I literally just pulled out the box and said, yeah, here we go.
Well,
so,
and it's interesting. Yeah,
it's a tough matchup for me.
For all of my love of Yoda and all my playtime with Yoda, I've actually never tried Yoda Chewie yet. It's on my list of things to try. We'll get there eventually.
It's, but, you know, it's real good. That Chewbacca card is real
good.
Oh,
yeah. I've seen it do cool things.
You can do some really dumb stuff, yeah.
So we're playing Breakthrough, Minefield, and Major Offensive. We're actually on Ryan's crate mat, so we have a nice little setup there. We've got blocking line of sight terrain. We've got trenches to run through, so we have difficult terrain. Of course, he's playing Wookiees, who don't care. I'm playing Grievous and Double Magnus, who also don't care. But, right? You know, yeah. We pretended like it was important for those people who it was important for, which is just robots. So, you know, clones in general, like a lot of people tend to play them in clumps. So they don't move a whole lot, but it's Breakthrough. And I have so many bodies. Sure. And so I'm just like, everybody to the front. And so Minefield, I was like, okay, it doesn't matter. We're just going to see if we can't blow some things up. See if I can't take the wounds. You know, this happens with me and Tim when we play Minefield. You know, I didn't have one set off, or I had to go off twice. Yeah. So cool.
Yeah. Cool.
Love that.
I kept hearing behind me like, oh, this mine now goes off twice. Oh, this mine now goes off. You guys had a couple of them double explode.
We had three double explodes. And then, yeah. Of course, the one mine didn't go off at all, because that's what happens in Minefield. One right. mine is in place where it doesn't work at all.
Exactly.
And here's the thing. With the double explodes, I think one damage was dealt in all of them. Like one each time it double explodes. It was just one of those. Is like it was blank hit, okay. And then block. Like it was okay. blank hit and then dodge, because you know you're gonna take a dodge token from when I walk into one. If I'm gonna make something explode,
sure.
So we both have a little bit of range 4-ish, 3-ish kind of stuff. Like it's, you know, Yoda's gonna do some things. He's gonna, you know, because it's Yoda. He's gonna do some nasty things.
Right.
But there's so much synergy in that list that it has to work. And because it's Breakthrough,
right.
You have to move.
Right. Yeah.
You just have to. And so by the end of turn 2, most of my army's on the center line of the map. Now it is Major Offensive, and because of the way terrain is set, I don't have a lot of open ways to get into it. I'm going to have to cross through basically 3 pockets. He has a nice little upper corner edge where if he can run fast enough and hide, like he's going to be able to get 2 units back behind my lines, and I'm going to have to put some Magnus over there to deal with him. So I'm looking, you know, Grievous is close. I can go jump in his main line, but I'm likely going to lose Grievous and not be able to do anything else after that. Or I can go try to slay these people that are trying to sneak around the side. So that's exactly what I do. My entire army pivots and looks at the Wookiees trying to run across the top of the map. They do not survive that run. But he does have his, because, you know, so much health on it. The Wookiee leader gets behind this big old tower piece that Ryan has printed. It looks really nice.
Oh, yeah.
So I can't shoot him anymore. So he forces me to take a Magna Guard around the tower to come and kill him, but it doesn't take me long. And those guys just sneak in on the Major Offensive on the backside. So we're watching the UT Florida game. So we take several breaks to watch with incredulity as that score is happening at that point.
As you should, yes.
As we should. At some point, literally, that final quarter, he's like, you know what? Let's just go watch this. So I go sit on the couch. Because this is a game store that has couches. It's really nice.
It's like, amazing.
Really fantastic setup in this place. So we were watching the game and we come back and play it. So it was a fun time. Had a great time with David. We plan to get out there again when my schedule allows me. But I like the store. And honestly, the drive is no different than me going to Sci-Fi City.
Yeah.
It's somehow one of those miracles of geography. It's 30 minutes for me no matter which way I go.
It's the miracles of the
store I'm adding to my rotation.
Miracles of Knoxville geography and Knoxville traffic, too. So.
Yes, that's also true. Like, I'm on the west side of Knoxville, so somehow 30 minutes this way, because it was easy and smooth. The only case is occasionally, you know, the interstate will get backed up. We right. saw all the traffic going into Knoxville for the game day. But by the time we left, it was long gone. So, yeah. 'Twas much fun. Had much enjoyableness. You know, we probably spent 4 hours playing that game. Behind me, Will and Ryan were playing.
Yeah, we did. I originally posted that I was going to go checking the store out, and Will's like, hey, let's grab a game. I was like, cool. And he messaged me like the night before. He's like, I think I've coerced Ben into coming. And I was like, he'll turn to stone. He'll never make it. He'll look back and be a pillar of salt. So me and Will show up. Will's made some nice additions to his table. That's kind of a urban nightlife kind of red light district in a sense, like lots of neon and crash spaceships and cool stuff.
Insert Daft Punk theme song right here, you know.
Sure, yeah.
A little bit of dubstep like, awesome, going.
Yeah.
So we set that up. I brought what I think is probably what I'm going to be tinkering with for a little while, which is kind of the Luke, Op Luke, double DLT captains. But instead of 4 DLT captains, I've got a Cassian and K2 slotted in there. So it's 10x. I think it's kind of the best of both worlds. It's fun to play. And Will brings the swoops. He's been painting and building them, so he just let me know that swoops are coming. I've not played against them.
So he's modified
yet.
The swoops all to pieces.
Yeah, they look
like,
really
it's,
great.
It's real. they look beautiful. They really do. Like, he's got one who's spear to B1 unit. The B1 is flying with his arms. Like, it's, yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's, we'll get some photos up on the...
They're awesome. It was 3 swoops, a bus with Bossk, 1 set of Black Sun, 3 pikes with disruptors, and a capo.
Which is just gross that you can fit all of that in a list.
Yeah, yeah, it is. It is.
I just be real honest. That's a lot. I mean, and the did he have the demoralized bot on the bus?
No, he had the frenzied. Okay.
Oh, that's right. The extra gunner or the extra die
big
guy.
Gun with the frenzied gunner. So it was a 7 die shot, which was quite spooky. We get the flop down, and the flop for it's my battle deck because I definitely don't want to play his with triple swoops in it, and it's not great for either of us. It's probably almost as good for my deck as Will could have kind of hoped for. And then we end up in a place where I'm not going to lie, I thought Will made a couple critical mistakes on turn 0 because we ended up on hemmed in payload, which is normally for the red player, which was Will, a death sentence. Payload is super tough to play as red. And then for our condition, we played, I don't even remember.
Rapid reinforcements.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we played rapid.
Because I remember this making a key difference in this game at some point.
Yeah, probably. It was probably pretty important. So I throw into rapid my 2 fleets. He hems and haws about what he wants to rapid, and then just makes the decision to put his Black Sun, which normally sit in the bus as a delivery system. He's like, you know, I'm going to rapid him just because I got to do something. And we deploy up and... reinforcements with those swoops means he gets to see where Luke is going to go, and I have to put Luke down because my original plan is I want to screen the bikes off with Luke. There's a building in the center of my blue player hemmed in deployment zone. My cart goes up there, and then Will only really had one piece of terrain that he could have logically selected for my cart to have to push to. He puts his in one of the as center as he can go of one of his deployment zones. I obviously have to go to the other side of the table to make him run further to mark the piece of terrain he has to take. And so we end up having to take our carts in almost opposite directions. They're not going to, there's not going to be like the X in the middle of the board where we all meet and fight. Right. So we've got to start making decisions once we start deploying. How much are we going to commit to offense versus how much are we going to commit to defense? On my left, I put my snipers because there was a great view of all of Will's pikes and his capo. My snipers go down there. My goal is to early on run up, poke somebody with K2, and then let the snipers and K2 walk the box. And then if he puts a lot of defense up on my box, I can drop my rapid reinforcements to go reinforce that, or Luke can go up that way if I really need to go. And then I put my rebel captain and my 2 DLTs with my range just to sit and babysit the piece of terrain that Will has to inevitably walk towards. And then Cassian kind of goes in the middle. And then I have to hedge what I'm doing, and I put Luke to babysit the snipers, but there's a pretty good route for him to burst of speed across the middle of the table where Will's bomb cart is going to be at the end of turn 3. So Luke's got some flex options. We begin playing, and turn 1 goes so incredibly poorly for me. Will brings his bus up, brings his bikes in. I can't find the core tokens in my bag to activate, to get dodge tokens up on my captains. The bus rolls up and I think gets 5 of my 6 rebel troopers in one of my squads before I can get a dodge token on them. There was some good terrain for me to kind of hide behind. It was just outside my deployment zone, so I needed to be able to find them to get them into some better cover. And between the bus and the bikes, my defensive flank that I was hoping to kind of be my late game, Bastion, is utterly, utterly tattered. I managed to get like 2 pikes with snipers. Cassian gets a wound somewhere. And my rebel troopers managed to plink some damage onto one of the swoops. I'm forced to rapid reinforce my both of my fleets to come play defense. I try to kind of zone out where the bikes are going to be next, hoping that eight white dice can chew through them. And he rapids his Black Sun Enforcer outside of range two of my little bastion of snipers. And so that's going to be a real problem because Black Sun against a full six-man Black Sun squad against two sniper strike teams is not great.
So since Will's not here, let me ask the question.
Sure.
Is reinforcements, did that make the difference on those swoops? Because Will and I talked about it that evening when we went to supper. Is reinforcements allowing him to drop those three swoops wherever he wanted because he already knew what yours was going to look like? The hemmed in didn't bother him as much because he could put them where he wanted to.
I think it made hemmed in less, red player hemmed in, a little bit less of a factor. No, I don't think so. Like, it meant he could just keep them away from Luke, which is good. But Luke wanted to catch Bossk and he wanted to get in the pike ball. I didn't really want to deal with the swoops with Luke. He only really had two options for where to put his bikes. He's gonna clear the way for his cart to move, or he's gonna stop my cart from moving.
So I've used the reinforcement cards with Kalani a couple of times, but normally I can already see where you're going to be. So I was like, I'm not going to spend the card here.
Yeah.
I'm just going to, because I like the refresh ability you have on it instead.
Yeah. So yeah. That's the thing. There's always so much you have to give up for that ability that, like, it's like,
swoops are just like, nope, we're just reinforced.
Right. Yeah.
We're just reinforced.
It's interesting that way.
Yeah. But Will had talked about how that just allowed him better placement to keep them away from Luke so they don't get eaten.
Yeah. Which, once again, didn't really super bother me because Luke doesn't want to have to be chasing down speeders. I was hoping, a fool's hope, I guess, that my rebel troopers would trade a little bit better. But I'm not going to lie, and I think Will would agree, once we started the shooting, Will just hot diced me. Absolutely hot diced me. Those swoops were rolling nothing but paint.
Twist of the wrist,
man.
Twist of the wrist.
It was, yeah. And like, he didn't make any big errors by any imagination to, like, I'm not trying to discredit his play, but like, his attack dice into my rebel troopers, into my K2, just all the shots having all the aim tokens from Bossk and the bus. He had a tactician on there, just nothing but paint. And then even his unmodified, like, pike shots were rolling like one blank die. Didn't need any search tokens. It was rough. The swoops hitting two, if not all three, of their overrun dice pretty consistently. It hurt. And so I was on the back foot. I think a couple activations into turn two, I was playing at like a three activation deficit. And like, I've got a Luke. I've got three heroes. So like, I can kind of make some stuff work. I played it out until there was no, you know, kind of no win condition left. My rebel troopers and my commander went down. My rebel commander, he got a lucky Bossk shot off on, or no, I think it was a bus shot, where he got into heavy cover, four hits after cover, and I just rolled four blanks. So he died, and I lost vigilance on turn one, I guess at the top of two. Just nothing was really going my way. Luke makes a dive. Luke starts to cut some people up. Luke does kind of dive onto Bossk, but my last bastion of hope was Luke kind of keeping everybody off of one side of half of the map while I let K2 kind of try to push my cart and use Luke to stymie up his, because I can't play defense because all my core are dead at this point. But the bus is quick enough and can outmaneuver Luke to where it, with its impact gun, managed to skate through and get a big hit onto K2, taking him out. And then my I conceded, I think it was turn four at that point, just because I had... It was Cassian and Luke were the only minis I had on the board. It was a rough game. It was a good game to play with Will. Sitting across from Shadow Collective at the start of any given round, and then, you know, there's 12 tokens on the table is pretty rough, and then there's an unorthodox tactician to throw some more out. All the independent nonsense is kind of frustrating to play against. I don't know if it's bad. It's just intimidating to look at. And then when the variance and the dice, just nothing went my way that game. It was a good game, but it was a rough game. So I've definitely lost some faith in that list. We'll see what shows up in Cincy.
The real important part is because y'all played quick because the dice were that rough. And
yeah, they were rough.
The whole thing just fell apart very quickly. You did get a game of MCP in.
Yeah, yeah. we did play some Marvel Crisis Protocol.
No, no.
Which I whipped Will's ass in.
Oh, you did, actually.
He's not here to defend himself.
you won that game, though.
Blood for blood.
Yeah.
But it was like a very, actually very tight MCP game. As far as MCP games, like it was very close.
And the only reason I won is because I did something really great on complete accident because I don't know how to read.
That's a game where dice can be swingy. I mean, it really can be swingy. But well, that's part of the
my
fun.
My dice and MCP were also not great. I think Will just kind of pulled a team of heroes together. I think my squad had a little bit more synergy, even though I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And then it came down to a big turn where I had Groot, and I played the Groot heals everybody card. And I just read it as, like, Groot heals a person. And then I just kind of magically measured, like, oh, my entire team is at the whatever range Groot needed to be to heal everybody. So I pulled, like, 12 or 15 wounds off the table.
It's a magic Groot heal. Look at it. It is.
Amazing.
So, yeah, I played the Guardians. He played a bunch of the Soviet villains. It was a weird game.
Will has a thematic issue with playing the bad guys. Like, I really think that's why he didn't enjoy the Empire when we first started this game.
Mm.
And at least with the clones, he can justify them as not being the bad guys.
But then he goes and picks up Shadow Collective.
I mean, yeah.
I mean, yeah, I know, there's some manipulation there. But remember, they're programmed that way.
Okay. Allegedly.
So, but he loves the little Soviet guys because some of the abilities they have, but he also has some issues playing the Soviets. So.
Yeah.
It's like Ursa Major and, you know, Iron Patriot or whatever it is they call him in the Soviet side.
So much to the chagrin of many STABcast fans, MCP was fine. That's my review. It's fine.
It's somewhere on the shelf for me, or I guess it was on the shelf, but
there's too many. The way my brain works, as someone who's just picking up the game, like, I need to be able to make informed decisions. And since everybody's got 15, you know, unique things that they can all do, which is a cool design space, but, like, I had no idea what I was doing, what I was supposed to be doing, or what Will's dudes were even capable of. So I definitely felt like I was just kind of treading water the entire game, and the game happened to me instead of me playing the game, if that makes sense.
So that was initially my problem with Guild Ball. I did not have informed decisions with Guild Ball because I couldn't make,
and I liked the structure of the game, but I just it was my, at that point, third minis game because I was still playing X-Wing at the time, and like I think I would have really liked that game a lot more, and I would probably like MCP more if I sat down and knew what everything did and could make more informed tactical choices, because that's the fun of the game for me.
So for me, that the fun of the game is the cartoon characters that are fighting each other with pew-pews.
Sure.
And I just learned to let go for that. Those games were also very thematic, the things we were playing. And there are people who pre-designed their list to better play with the mechanics, which I clearly did not do.
Right.
So I got an ass whooping every time. I did not win any of those games. I was okay with it, though, because I said, this is just the nature of this game. It's perfectly fine. I'm having fun playing it. But I definitely have to be at a place where I can cut that off.
Yeah. And I don't know that my brain works that way. Maybe I'm wrong. But it definitely felt like I was drowning for most of that game. And then I looked up and won. It was neat.
So, Tim, you have transitioned. You're in the north.
I have.
You're in a new city. New people.
I have.
New game
stores. I have gone back to the Great White North. Yes. So I guess I was born and raised in Long Island, so I left New York, and then now I've returned to New York after a 13-year hiatus, but it's just a little bit farther north than Long Island, just by 7 hours. So I'm up in the Rochester area.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, 7 hours north. It's just 7 hours northwest.
Okay, fair enough. But I'm still 7 hours away from where I was born and raised.
You're not a Canadian. But you're
but I'm damn close. The city is on Lake Ontario. So, but yes. So
the line's like 20 feet out there.
Up in Rochester. So, yeah. Long, very nice Hallmarky story short. Found some family up here, and now I'm got to be closer to them. So it is a wonderful time, but I am in the process of moving everything over still and all the logistics that come with that. And so I have been blessed to be able to be a part of Invader League this season, because I don't have to set anything up and everything can stay in boxes here. So that's good. I do want to play. I know actually Rochester and Buffalo, upstate New York area is a hotbed of Legion activity, actually.
Sure, yeah.
And some of the best players in the world are up here, which is amazing for me. So it's like going from the frying pan into the fire. But it's just a cold fire because of the snow. But we're not there yet, thankfully. It's just pretty fall. It's the pre-snow. But yes, so...
It's only October the 2nd when we record this episode.
Yes, exactly.
So soon you will have snow.
Exactly, yes.
We do really appreciate you going up to that place where a lot of the good Legion players are, just to really help bring that average back to where it needs to
be. Exactly, yes. It's really a public service. That's what I'm doing. I do this for you, listeners, as the community administrator. You know, I lend myself out to be used by the better community so that I might service all of the area and really... all of you at home. So you're welcome, America and the world.
You should get to pay extra for them to service you at home.
That's right. Rochester prices, it's taxes and stuff, so we don't talk about that. So
but I will say, because I had to look it up. Sorry, Tim. Yes, I didn't have to go look this up. Okay. The first average snowfall for city of Buffalo, Rochester is October the 24th.
So what's interesting is Buffalo tends to get more snow than Rochester. And even though there's only like an hour difference, it's just weird how that works out. Something about topography and geography and things. And
yeah.
It's almost like
how they sit on that lake and where weather comes down.
It's the weather, and even more so, like Syracuse gets it worse than us because it goes over Rochester and then hits Syracuse, which is interesting. Yeah. But anyway, this is not a weather podcast.
The MCP / Star Wars season / meteorology podcast.
That's right.
First inch or more tends to be first or second week of November. I'm just saying it's coming. It's coming.
Oh, yeah.
Winter's coming.
Exactly. Winter's coming.
This tangent brought to you by the Weather Channel.
But I have actually gotten to play. Before I left, I played some Legion, and then I've been playing some Legion online. So I've actually had several games, so it's kind of hard to choose from. But I will go for my first Invader game of the season against the mighty Timbo of the 5th Trooper Network, which I'm now close to him and close to them. Oh, but yes.
It's true, yeah.
I played against Timbo.
You've always been close to them.
Yes, and he also had a comment on this, and I told him to tell everyone what happened on his side of the cast, so I hope to hear their report of it as well. But basically, I am playing, because I don't think I've talked about my Invader list, I am playing Din, because he's legal for Invader, and I wanted to try out the new thing. Yes. Din, absolutely. But I wanted to do it in a different flavor, because everyone's doing like Din Boba or something like that. Like, it's kind of boring to me. So I got Din Triple Bike ATST. And
I love the idea of this.
It's 10X.
I got it to
10X. It's also Gideon, Gideon in a storm, a short trooper, and a mortar. And then also another naked stormtrooper. It gets with an officer, gets me up to 10. Boom, done. I actually really like it. And there's a little bit of a back control issue, which we could really do a deep dive on. But part of that is also built into the list construction. So my order almost always goes to Gideon, who then directs to the shore, who then directs to the mortar. And then bada bing, with standing orders, I have 3 orders out of my bag. What I would argue also are the crappy orders. So then I only have another core, and then everyone else that I'd rather draw. So it's not total control, but it's like controlled chaos almost.
It's not bad.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, I played a while back in Tampa, Jordan, and he had a Vader CAD list.
Yeah.
And he didn't have the extra stormtrooper because he just wanted the... It was a Gideon Snow short mortar, because he's just like, I'm just going to make sure whatever order I play goes onto my snow so it gets my terrible axe out. And so I'd almost wonder if you cut that extra core if you've got another duplicate slot, maybe even another officer to spool somebody up just to clean that bag up even more.
Yeah, I could. I have a 6-point bid right now, which is enough to get me blue player in... 4 out of 5 games I'm playing in Invader, so that's awesome. Yeah. My whole pot, I should take it.
If they'll ever give us a 55-point operative, perhaps we could do a thing.
I will say, my whole pod, all of us are Civil War factions, or either Rebels or Empire. And
this happened to you last year, too, didn't it?
It did. This is the second year in a row where it's happened, and I hate it. I hate it, but it's whatever. And everyone in this pod... has some kind of Boba or Din in their list.
I think that's probably true for most of Invader.
It's so stupid. No, there's numbers for that, but that's a separate conversation. But yeah, there are numbers for that as far as who has what. There's a lot more bobas than dins, which I thought was really interesting. But it's also, I guess, lots of rebel boba. I don't know. So anyway, so I got to play against Lando boba. Lando boba I see a lot of, or also Lando din.
Yeah. I get that.
Yeah. It was an interesting combo for sure. It was 11 acts. So he had me up on acts, which actually really helped him a lot. And we played Sabotage, Supply, and Long March. I was still blue player by a point, I believe. But yeah, so we played it out. We played on, for those that are on Invader or on TTS, played on the Geonosis map. I had to think of it. Yeah, Geonosis map, which is interesting. And this is my second TTS game in a very long time. I should say that disclaimer. I had one practice game just because I needed to learn the controls again. And it's still, I still hate TTS. As someone who is actively in Invader League and I love the idea of Invader League, God, I hate TTS so much. But anyway, I'm still going to keep playing. I'm not like dropping, but yeah, yeah. Anyway, the first round or whatever, you know, we're just tapping our VAPs, whatever. Pretty straightforward stuff. And basically nothing happens for a little while because it's Long March and, you know, he's got his list. He's got a couple snipers. He got a pot shot off on Din, but nothing happened because he could see my base and I didn't realize it. Again, joys of TTS. And so long story short, first couple rounds, nothing, no action. And then we start shooting. He got a rebel squad. So my Gideon was moving up, right? My VAPs are tapped. Gideon's moving up. He's on the front line. Okay, he was in, I think maybe it was he moved up to get a no-shot cover. So he moved up, aimless shot, just rebel squad or whatever, moved up, take a shot at him. Okay. Throws a boatload of dice. Got it. One shots Gideon squad. He rolled six hits with whatever he was shooting with. I forget what unit he was shooting with. He rolled six hits. I rolled six blanks on red dice.
Ouch.
So, yeah, one shot of that, and then I couldn't just do anything. Anything I rolled was just none of my defense was there. My offense was half-baked. Like, it was just nothing I could roll to do anything. I definitely made a mistake. I will say, I think it was round three or something like that, where I relayed an order off of Din when I shouldn't have, because I do have comms relay on Din. And I also have the, whatchamacallit, the spear. I have the spear instead of the gun, which I actually stand by that still to this. I've played two games with him now, or three games with it, and I stand by that. Din was able to charge in. He charged in. He hit Lando with his relentless attack. So he move. So he got three aims on him because he didn't have an order that turn. So three aims, hit Lando, pierce two. Lando blocks all of it, takes no damage. Actually, I'm sorry, he takes two because it pierced two. But blocks all of it. And I was like, okay, awesome. And then, yeah, Mando just kind of got just murdered because then Lando withdrew. And I was so shocked by that play that it caused me to have a massive screw up, which probably, I would argue, it's probably my biggest screw up of the game because you can't predict that. Like, that should have been a good hit, but whatever.
Right.
Lando is invincible. And both games I've played against him have been awful. But anyway, took a swipe, couldn't do it. And then I was so shocked by that that I forgot to freaking play Lando's Flaw. Play Lando's Flaw. Yep. Yeah. And I have no excuse for that. Like, that's just an error. Like, you can get mad at dice all you want, but that error is 100% on me. And
sure.
So, yeah. So I forgot to play the Flaw, which then cost Din his life because then Lando got to go first. And as soon as he played Lando's card, I was like, shit, I knew better. And I was just... Yeah, I was really reeling from having several rolls. That was the same turn I lost Hask and things like that. It's like, it was just, everything was going against me, and yeah, it was rough. So long story short, he weeded through a bunch of my units. My ATSD was shooting Boba. Oh, that's right. Boba survived like three bike attacks and double ATSD shots. Boba wouldn't go down. He was only in light cover. Doesn't matter. He just wouldn't go down.
I mean, to be fair, like, if you blanked all your red saves, like, he's just bringing them back into balance, like, to make sure that the red saves over the course of the game are
absolutely insane. I just couldn't bring Boba down, no matter. And then I had a bunch of suppression. I was like, well, if I can't kill him, I'll panic him. Nope, he rallied it like half of it off.
Yeah, okay. it's almost impossible to like panic courage three units.
Bullshit. I've done it many times. But when they when they roll it all off, then it's impossible.
Yeah. And I've seen places where Sabine will do something similar, where she'll block all the hits, she won't be suppressed at all, she'll roll all the pieces. But I've also seen her just collapse. Like, I had red dice and I am impervious. Oh, didn't matter, dead.
Yeah. Well, I had a Sabine game too, but I'm not going to talk about multiple games. But yes, that was where she also took three ATST shots, four core shots, three bike shots. Like, it just took everything. It didn't hit. Nope, nothing did it. She wouldn't go down.
You can shoot at things that don't have surging red saves, Tim.
You know, Ryan, sometimes you have to shoot things to try and win the game. So sometimes things have to die in order for you to win. If I don't, that game,
you just eat up your things.
Again, I won't go into detail about that game. If I don't kill Sabine, I lose. That's it.
Sure. Like, okay, fair.
Yeah. Because then she's in the back line and she chews up all my back line. But anyway, I won that game. So it was good. But also, that was a very good game that Lando would not go down. But yeah,
Lando's slippier. He's slippery.
Well, he is when he rolls all his blocks over and over again. It's fine. And so, yeah, long story short, it just was a whole bunch of plinking and just couldn't get him down. My Din died. His Boba wouldn't go down. No one scored bounty, but that was fine. And and I ended up calling it. And I did make a mistake here. Again, I'm so out of the invader world and everything that I wasn't thinking that they're doing, like, basically MOV. And so it was turn five. And I was like, you know, I was like, there's no point in playing this out. Like, you're not going to hit my VAPs. Like, he was moving towards my VAP, but he would not have had the speed and not have been able to make it. I was like, it's just going to be. Well, yeah, because I was like, it's going to be 2-2, and then you'll win on kill points. Because I lost, I think, five activations. Ladies and gentlemen, he lost zero.
Mm-hmm.
Against a Din triple bike ATSD list. He lost no activations. Rebels. So, it was super frustrating. So I was like, you know what? I'm good. I can't kill anything. So I'm just good here. And I didn't think about, like, it's not just a loss. It's a 0-3 or whatever. So that,
right. Yeah.
That hurt
weird invader scoring system. Yeah.
Yeah. Fast forward for invader things. If it comes up to where myself and someone else are tied to make the cut, I might lose the cut because of that, which makes me sad, but it is what it is. I just didn't think about it at the time. I mean, Timbo's a great player too, so I don't want to discount him. He was a great player. Yeah. He did everything right.
We are a very pro Timbo podcast. So
I don't know about that. I wouldn't go that far.
No, I can't.
I am a very pro Timbo podcast.
I remember that box.
The scarf of justice is long and wide, but it does not bend towards Timbo. All right. So he was a great player. He was a great sport. It's one of those things, like, at certain point, you just have to start laughing at the dice, and you're just like, this is awful. And so that's what I kept telling him throughout the whole game. I was like, you tell people. You tell them what happened this day. Like, you tell them what you saw. And he even said, he's like, I don't know what it is about your dice, but every time we play, your dice just blank out. I was like, yes, good. It's every game.
You should
game
just ask him to roll them for you. Will you please roll my
dice
have. For me?
Jeez, yeah. Yeah, anyway.
All right. So listen, I know Ryan takes absolutely no photos of his games.
Sure don't.
You can take screenshots, right? You took many screenshots of this game.
I took one, maybe. I was busy dying, man. Like,
well, we got lucky in our game that the store people took photos for us. So you will see many cinematic moments of the game that Ryan and Will played, including a little MCP, and of course my game with David. If Tim will throw one up in the Instagram, we'll take
and
some
I
photos that Will has posted
photos
in our group
from our it's local Wednesday Legion.
Fantastic!
Because
listen.
I didn't have a game. I was the odd
man. We have many people who've been trying to interview for Tim's spot on the podcast because they think
true.
He might be leaving.
Yeah, because you guys said I was gone. You didn't say that I had moved. You said I was gone. And I heard that on the show. Dentist, I was like, damn dentist. It, now everyone's going to think I'm gone. I'm like, no, I'm still
listen,
here.
The interview process has started.
No,
most of them have been sending me photos. They're like, listen, I take photos of the games I play. Can I join your podcast?
STABcast,
two of the four players.
STABcast North is now well established, and we're getting our pocket of resistance building. It's fine.
STABcast
exactly.
North. Those two words don't drive together.
Listen, we can build a Sun Sphere over there.
So, speaking of social medias, if you want to find us on the Facebook or the Twitter, you can rate us on our listening platform of choice or your listening platform of choice, wherever we're available, find us on all the socials. You can also find us on the Discord, especially with Invader going on and me being in it. I'm in there. Because of the move, my schedule is actually pretty free right now, because it's amazing what happens when you just leave.
No other obligations.
Yeah. When you give up your dog, your wife, your home, your job.
It's great. Now, granted, you cry a lot, but that's okay. So when you're not busy crying.
That's not different, though.
That's true. I'm still drunk while I'm crying, so it's okay. I still bought whiskey. So in between my bouts of tears, I might be able to get some streaming done. So I would love to nice. Be able to actually get back to streaming with some newfound time. So that'd be great. That's my hope.
Nice.
Yeah. My hope is honestly to play my games, get them done, and then I can maybe pick up some streaming because I got the spare time. Yeah. So we'll see.
If you want to support this little endeavor we have going and Tim's moving GoFundMe, you can go to teespring.com/stores/stabcast.
I don't have one of those, but if I can set one up and if people want to do that, that's fine. Like, we can do that.
Listen, right now he has both a mortgage and some rent, so he's got
right. And moving costs too. Don't forget how much it is to move. It's expensive to exist.
Or if you just want to talk to us, you can send us an email at swstabcast@gmail.com.
You can always message me on Discord. Absolutely. Oh, by the way, I will say I have multiple friend requests pending. Don't just add me on Discord. Like, tell me who you are. Tag me somewhere and say, like, hey, I'm adding you. Because I'm not just going to accept random friend requests on Discord.
Well, what if you did?
Sorry, you folks. Like, I'm just not.
Speaking of random friend requests, we've got some tournaments and events coming up.
We do.
Well, that's a
segue.
So.
Yes.
It is. I reached for the straws. I'm Wilhelm in spirit.
You did try it. Hey, let's talk about some other social media type platforms and events we're engaged in. So traditionally in the past, I have done fantasy football in multiple places. Oh. This year seemed like all my groups were falling apart, and I'm only in one this year.
I feel that.
And so I asked Tim, are you doing any fantasy football? Oh, no, not really. I'm kind of mumble mouth. It's like, okay, cool.
BS.
He's moving. I get that. What?
I invited you.
No, I find out.
That's a lie. I said, do you want to do a league? And you were like, no, I don't. I'm too busy. Time about time. Blah, blah, blah. Principal. Bow tie. That's what you said.
No, I said I would do a second league. That was what Will said. Will was like, eh, he didn't care about it. I would have joined a second league.
I would have. If I had known.
I bring all this up because I find out that Tim is in a secret Legion inspired fantasy football game.
It wasn't secret.
In which
it was
he just
topic.
Lost to friend of the podcast, LJ.
Oh, God.
He lost to LJ last week, is what I'm told.
I did. So it was super close.
I was told to bring it up here.
It was. If it wasn't for.
When Mr. Talk Polite tells you to do a thing, you say yes, sir. So
if it wasn't for one of his players just spouting off, I would have won that game. But it was. I forget what player it was, but he just got like 40, literally 40 points. I was like, oh, okay. We're just going to lose. That's fine. Because I lost by, I think, 5 points, something like that. Good times. I'm 1-2 in the league so far. And I'm going to probably lose to good old Peregrine here this week. I'm looking at it right now.
Ooh. You know me. I can only check the Discord about once every 14 hours. So when I do, 900 messages have been played. I never see any of these pieces.
Here you go. So not only that. So Lamar Jackson had 40.42 points.
Yes, I know.
And not only that.
That's my quarterback in my league.
Peregrine traded him to LJ that week. He had just freshly traded.
Oh,
so the subtitle under Lamar Jackson is...
Hi, STABcast listeners. I'm still here for you.
From Peregrine with love. That's what it said. And now he's come to slap me in the face in person. Because friends hurt friends. That's what happened.
That's honestly, welcome to our podcast. That's exactly how this works. So.
And now he's going to hurt me again. It's fine. First he trades.
For those of you who are not football enthusiasts, listen, we have fun with it. In fact, I was in a league with Tim and Will just for the kicks and giggles because sometimes it is fun to hurt
friends. It was a great time. Yes.
But I also, Lamar Jackson is on my only team that I have this year. So I appreciate him every time he spouts off. So.
I need Herbert to be a winner. But anyway, speaking of real events.
So you're currently 1-1. So you're currently 1-1 in your Invader season.
Yes.
When do those round robins end? Is it October?
We've got some time.
We've got some time. You have to have two games played by the end of this weekend.
And normally we'll start seeing some sheds right there. People who just can't manage to make that work. We'll see some people.
I've gotten my two in, and I actually got a third one hopefully lined up for Tuesday. So that should be good.
Nice. So check out those streams on side the Legion Discord. Michigan GT is happening right now.
Yes.
So traditionally we record this podcast. If you want a little behind the scenes, some sausage making, stuffing, that's casing. We record this normally on like a Friday night, sometimes a Thursday night, maybe a Saturday morning. But we have done a Sunday morning now, so we already know what day one looks like for Michigan GT. And so our buddy Alpaz is 2-1, yep. But 13th of the 27 players that are there.
I got to work on that MLB pal.
It's real, real bad. It's real bad. There are 3-3-0s as of right now. I assume they're going to a cut today. One of those, the 3-0s, is our buddy Jay Muth, who's currently 3-0, second in MOV, because the first player has like a 0.99. He's given up like a single victory point this entire time. It's so gross.
That's rough, yeah.
So gross. It's like, but yeah, those lists aren't quite open yet, but we know what Jay's playing. It involves bikes and all of them.
As he should, yes.
Glad to hear that is going well for him. We wish him much success for this day. Of course, by the time the pod comes out, we'll know exactly who won the thing. But
right, yeah.
We did talk about the Unlimited Power Springfield, Missouri event, which we, of course, that's a little bit too far for us. We were going to shout them out for them. They got a good number of players, except their list were open. So I clicked on it to see what the number one player had. It was 4-0 yesterday. It is a double ATST list. Snowtroopers and Dells, some Storms. With DLTs, another set of Storms, some Snipers, and just a General Weiss, all the guns, link targeting array, and then just a regular ATST with a hammer pilot and two gun, or the light blaster cannon. Just love it. Love it, but also, that's a silly place and we shall never go.
It's interesting, yeah. I also want to
Love it. I just saw, when I was cleaning these things up, I was like, that is fantastic.
I really want to try
a 789 bid, by the way.
Yeah, wow, that's a huge bid.
That's gross.
Yeah, huge bid.
I really want to try a double ATSD Blizzard Force list. We'll see.
I can see it.
We'll see.
Will you spend all the points in the heavies? I don't know. Point wise,
I've not built it yet. I just want to try it. We'll see.
Yeah.
But anyway.
I always love an ATSD. And I know this seems like we keep talking about ATSDs this week because this is the fourth time we've mentioned
them. That's true. I want to bring it.
I do. Yeah. I mean, I do love it. I mean, yeah. I do.
They're
love
fun.
It, love it. Love it.
When there's not ion spiders around, I like to bring them out. It's great.
Yeah, that's exactly.
I
know there's lots of pikes have scared all those away. So
they're impact one here and there is fine. I can deal with that with an 11 health unit. I can deal with that.
I know we're not talking about it on this podcast today, but that list breakdown, that faction breakdown for Invader League did surprise me that there are still very few CIS there.
It's very interesting.
It's interesting
and very few Shadow Quests
because they can't take Din and Bofa.
There's very few Shadow Collectors probably because of that. But yeah.
And I'll be real honest, I looked today, I was like, wait, is that my icon on there? The Empire? Because the light blue makes no sense to me for the Imperial color. So it always, when we're looking at what factions can take these things.
Well, if you'd like to see Ben squint and try and read cards, you could maybe see him at the Cincinnati Open. Which is going to be this weekend coming up.
I feel bad that you're the one who had to read that because you don't get to go.
I'm very sad. Yeah, because of the move, everyone. I know I'm the one that brought it forth, the one that promoted it, and then now I can't go, which I'm very sad.
And then we all jumped in. I mean, there was nobody. I think there's like three people signed up. Now we're at 15.
Yes.
So I think the other people who are probably bought tickets but haven't actually signed up for it. So we're planning on having a great time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sadly, it's honestly, about 8 hours away from me, so I'm out. Sorry, folks.
Yeah. We've got hotel rooms set up. I don't think there's a lot going to be on. I think Alpaz are going to drive down and join us. So we may just be getting boozy and playing some Legion.
Yeah, it's going to be a STABcast and STABcast adjacent bloodbath.
But again, all four of us can't be there.
We like out of there. I mean, that's right. Exactly. Yeah. That's true. One of us always designated Survivor.
So really, just blame Paz. That's it. That's a t-shirt. New t-shirt coming soon from the STABcast. STABcast, just blame Paz.
Just blame Paz.
But Will can never wear it.
That's right. We have to keep him safe.
Following weekend, Ryan, where are we going?
Weekend, you can go a couple of different places depending on where you are in the country. There's the SoCal Open out in San Diego. I have a ticket, but airline prices have not done nice things, so I'm not sadly going to be able to make it, which hurts because I had a lot of fun last year. So instead, it's hard to fly literally across the country to an event when there is the Chattanooga Comic Con 90 minutes away the same weekend. So $50 gets you in the door, gets you a Legion pass. And our good buddy Chris Vandergriff is putting that on. So hope to see you guys down there. I should be there, barring any strange circumstances. And if you're on the West Coast or the East Coast, you have an option for Legion on October 22nd to the 23rd.
There you go. Yeah,
now, I also want to say, too, I didn't have this in the notes, but we were talking about it before. So even though I will not be at Cincinnati Open, there is a tournament up here in Rochester, Just Games in Rochester, on the 8th. So if you're in town and you're listening to this, because you should
go greet Tim with a good heart shellacking.
Yeah. I had to look at the calendar. Yeah. You'll hear this in good time. So yeah.
Yeah.
Come out, Just Games. I don't know what time it starts, but we'll figure it out. It's fine.
And remember, if you haven't played Street Legion, Tim knows how to play Street Legion.
That's true. It's that dirty Southern Legion. That's right.
That's really what it is.
Also, speaking of the West Coast before, it is the Golden State Games Worlds Qualifier, which just rolls right off the tongue. It's great. It should be a 64-man event, top four getting invites, and first gets an airfare and hotel. And that's November 5th to the 6th. So yeah, it's huge.
I am very interested in what the meta shakes out of there, what the games look like. Yeah. Has anyone heard of streaming options for that?
I don't think.
I have no idea.
So
probably not.
I don't think so. I haven't seen anything. Yeah. I read that forum very rarely. So
yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure.
But I know they streamed SoCal, and I know a lot of that is Keegan's gear, and he's out that way. So maybe I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. But then also on our side of the coast, on the East Coast, you have Queen City Charity Tournament in Concord, North Carolina, which is the following weekend, the 12th to the 13th. So November 12th to the 13th, there's a charity tournament. I imagine because it's Queen City, that will actually probably be streamed because they did the streaming for charity.
Yeah, I don't know if Jordan's going to be streaming the event or just running it. I know that can be a lot to do, so we'll see.
Maybe he'll record it.
It is also going to be a charity event, so I know some game stores do like donate stuff, get extra perks and stuff in your games, which is fine for a charity event. I need to find the details on that event. I'll figure that out when we get to November and we get closer.
Yeah,
so I do want to go. Jordan came and helped us out with the Cherokee Open earlier. Yeah. In the year, I'd like to pay the favor back.
Yeah, for sure.
Much fun. So now that Tim lives up a little bit further north,
yeah,
I know Ryan always likes to talk about going to PAX. It's December 2nd through the 4th. Tim, are you thinking about going to PAX? I mean, you're actually within 6 hours now?
I am going to PAX. I am signed up, and I can.
Nice. Oh, nice.
Yeah, about 6.5 hours. So I will probably drive. I would love to take the train, but because of the way Amtrak works out, I would have to take that Friday off, basically, or try and work on the train. So most likely, easiest way is just drive down. 6.5 isn't that bad. That's normally I do 6 is kind of my bubble, but for PAX, I'll suck up the extra half hour. It's fine. But yeah, so PAX Unplugged is December, 2nd to the 4th? Yeah, it's for the whole weekend. So it is a free event, technically. You do have to pay for your PAX badge, but there is no Legion price, so that is good. I will say the hotels are a little pricey, so that can be a little bit tricky, but it's going to be put on by Nick Bodnar, and I'm so looking forward to that. Also, Fifth Trooper will be heavily represented there as well, and and as well as other Legion members, I think the Discord and things like that, are promoting and helping so that the top four will get their airfare paid for Adepticon. As well as, I like that. That's nice for the top four. But let's face it, sometimes the same people keep winning events because they're really good and it happens.
Right.
Sure. And so like, oh wow, my airfare has been paid twice. Great. Yeah. But there's also going to be a raffle for two other given at random flights paid, like a flight voucher for Adepticon. So now in order to get the voucher, you have to play all your games. So you can't just like play one, drop and be like, oh, I hope I get a free flight. No. So you do need to play all your games. But I love that format. I love the two randoms makes it easy to want to stay in for the whole time, which I normally would stay in the whole time anyway. But just in case, you know, it just gives it a little extra incentive to stay.
No, that's huge. That's awesome.
Yeah. So it'll be great.
And I mean, you're going to need an incentive to stay and play at PAX because it's, you know, it's not like this is the only thing, you know, we go to a frontline gaming event.
There's a lot of things going on at
the event. That's the only thing to do since we're not going to go like next door and play 40K. But PAX, there's tons of stuff to do.
Yeah.
For sure. So giving people some incentive to keep playing is awesome. Yeah.
And Philly too. I mean, not for nothing. Like you can just go around Philly and do stuff in Philly.
Yeah.
It's a cool city.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff to do in Philly. Yeah. And again, survive. If you're going to go play, the tables he puts together. I mean, I give him a lot of grief and all that kind of stuff. But I'm looking at photos right now from the Discord. Oh, they're such beautiful tables.
We love to hate on Nick, but
yeah,
the amount of tables he has too.
I'm just going to leave it at that. We just love to hate on Nick.
That man. I think his goal, unofficially, I think his goal is to be able to, at one point, maybe not this year, but next year, maybe, to be able to supply all of PAX tables himself. And he is...
Yeah. Damn, oh, sure. Yeah.
He's damn close. I think he has 25, 26 tables worth of stuff.
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, he's real close.
So, we were looking... I was browsing around the Discord, and I saw a December 10th date, and I thought, oh, that makes me sad, because that was New Orleans last year, and I had a great time at that. Yep. But then I saw, oh, wait, there is an event, and they're having one in Boston. And apparently, there's a game convention called Everwinter. We don't travel north, but Tim has opened our eyes.
Now I might, yeah. Because
it's also about 6 hours away from Tim.
Yeah, it's a little bit farther outside that bubble. But again, I might be able to push to make that. Being December, and I mean, because December starts to be family time, and I moved up here for family, I'm not going to overpromise. But if I can make it work, I'd like to go. Yeah, it'd be great.
And there's snow. I mean, Tim would have to really get into snow driving, which he hasn't had to do in a while.
I haven't had to do it in a while, but I do have a truck, so I'm all right. Like a four-wheel drive.
Yeah, you do. You do. I'm just saying, it's been a while since you've had to really, you know, deal with it.
Listen, the last time when we had that big Christmas Eve snow in Knoxville, which was not big, but for Knoxville it was big, and everyone was staying home and driving off the roads, my Christmas Eve tradition is to get Chinese food.
So weird.
Damn it.
He's a New Yorker. It makes sense.
Yeah, that's fair. Because normally you're cooking everything on Christmas Day. So, like, that's where all your cooking's going. So, you don't have to cook Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. So, with all the family over, just get Chinese for the family. It's easy. Anyway, and it's fun. It's neat. And they're open. So, yeah, I was able to utilize the truck, and everyone was driving off the road. I was like, I have my traditions, and I am a man of principle, and so I'm going to get my food. And the Chinese place is even like, are you sure you're going to make it? I was like, yes, I'll make it. You goddamn right, I'm going to make it. I'm going to get my Chinese food, damn it. Merry Christmas.
See, where the Knoxville tradition of snow is, just shut it down, folks. Don't go out. It's fine. Because in a day and a half, it'll be all cleared up. There's a
flurry. We got to go buy all the milk, all the eggs at the Walmart and the Kroger's.
Yes, exactly.
And then stay in your house for 4 days.
I think you mean the Wegmans.
We do not have a Wegmans here, sir. Take your Yankee business north. But anyhow, there is an event in Boston, but it actually looked really nice. Then I started browsing the website, you know, looking at the things. And if it were a place I could get to easily, I would definitely do it. Like I said,
sure.
Boston in the winter? Sounds fine.
Yeah.
I guess our next big event after that is LVO at the end of January.
Yeah, and then we're at the start of the start slash end of the season again. I feel like it's the start of the year, but you know, usually the last big event before Adepticon. So
Ryan, are you locked in for LVO?
I'm locked into. I have a ticket. I should be there. There's about an 80% chance that I go because I've gotten most of the expenses paid for already.
Yeah. That's. I'm locked in to go.
Sell that body.
Even when I started a new job, I made sure that was a cleared vacation already. So yeah. I need to get my flights, but other than that, I'll go. So unless flights become like $1,000, I should be fine.
The hotel lottery went up for Adepticon and was immediately sold out already.
Yeah.
So we'll talk about Adepticon for the following year because that's where Worlds will be.
Yeah.
It's definitely a thing. Nope, that hotel was, I mean, it was quick. Like, I even tried. Like, I made sure I was at a place that, not even.
It was gone.
So I haven't even signed up for a hotel yet.
I've Adepticon's housing lottery, the connected hotel, I think mostly is pre-sold before the lottery even goes live because I think that's where all the vendors and you know, the people who actually make the show happen eat up a lot of that hotel.
And I will say it's not necessary. You can definitely drive over. Parking's relatively okay. You can walk, except, you know, it's Chicago in March. So it's going to snow at some point. It's going to flurry at least. But you know, like it's perfectly fine if you're not connected, but it is so nice when it's connected. I'm looking forward to going to Cincy just because we don't have to go anywhere if we don't really want to.
Right.
I'm sure and we can get all the food delivered. We can we can get boozy in the hotel and never have to leave. So this is the place where Will would traditionally transition us to the news after some prompting.
The news.
But since Will's not here because he's still asleep.
That's right.
I do think he's dead.
I think he's dead.
Oh, yeah. Hopefully.
So that's maybe, really awkward. Maybe we're going to have to scrub some of this if he is
That's true. Yeah. If it turns out he's passed, we're definitely going to have a...
We'll figure that out by Wednesday. Yeah. We can edit that out.
This is... Ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening to this pause, after this long pause, we're sorry to inform you, our dear friend.
Daisy ate his
Wilhelm's plane crashed into the South China Sea.
Daisy, but we did Daisy have some definitely movie. Sabotaged his fuel lines.
Oh, she so did. So I've been so busy at work, and I don't get to check my personal cell phone a lot anymore. In fact, I don't even carry it. It sits in my bag underneath my desk. Sometimes if I hear it vibrate and I've got a second, I may take a look at it. But so I got the message that said we had some news about the IG-88s and the IG-11s.
Yeah,
what buddy. Was that news?
Well, it was pretty much, they told us, they ripped the Band-Aid off and gave us all the cards we were missing. You wanna take 88, Tim, as the reformed Imperial player, and I'll take...
I'm playing Imperial in Invader right now.
That's true.
I know. Every time I refer to what faction you play, it's just always Former, because you've bounced around.
Fair. That's fair. Still a Giants fan, though, even though it hurts. So, it worked. But anyway...
Oh,
yeah, I know. Even when it hurts,
just be. I know. I know you can't give it up. I know you're so close to Buffalo. It's so easy for you to say you've been a New York fan this entire time.
Well, no. To be fair, I have been a Bills fan number two for a long time. So they still are number two for me. Right. So number one is still Giants. So at least I'm on a bandwagon. Because if I was a bandwagon, I would have jumped off the Giants bandwagon a long time ago. Because that bandwagon's on fire. But anyway, we have a slightly better driver now because in the new coach, who's ironically from Buffalo. But yeah. Anyway.
Oh, back to football talk.
Let's go. Ryan will zone out for the next 90 seconds. Okay.
But IG-88, the ultimate football player. That's what his weird title for a droid and legion, but there it is.
Yeah, it's a weird subtitle on his card.
Notorious assassin football player. Armor 1, Arsenal 2, Bounty. We already know all his unit card and all that stuff. We're not going to go rehash all that. His one pip. So I guess we should state, too, for the IG pack, right, there are 2-1 pips, 2-2 pips, and then... I got that order wrong. No, it's 2-1 pips. Three pip. I don't know. So there's a whole bunch of cards you can use for a bunch of them.
Yeah. So there's a 2 pip that you can do either IG-11 or an IG-88.
Right.
But IG-88 also comes with his own 2 pip.
I looked at it in the wrong order. That's my problem. Anyway.
Yeah. So and if I'm not mistaken, 88 for the Empire does not have access to a 3 pip. He's got access to 3 command cards, but it's a 1-2-2.
Correct.
Yes.
Yes. Correct. Got it. Which is interesting note. Thank you, Ryan. I actually didn't realize that. It's a good point. Because normally when you see that, it says like the little text of treat this as a 3-pip, yada, yada.
Right,
or something like that.
No,
so I didn't think of that.
It's a 1-2-2.
Anyway, so let's start with a 1-pip. Focused on the kill for Mr. IG-88. It is permanent. Well, it is while IG-88 is performing an attack against a unit that is the target of a bounty keyword, that unit cannot spend tokens. Any tokens. And also... if IG-88 has wounds equal to or exceeding his wound threshold, he is not defeated until the start of the end phase. Now, let's address some things on the front end of this card. I guess the questions that are raised the reading of this card. You cannot repair him back down after he has exceeded those wounds. You can, right. But it won't do anything. He's still defeated because he has exceeded his threshold. It is gone. So he will go away. So don't bother bringing like two or three repair bots to try and keep him invincible for forever. It does not work. We already talked about that. It's already on the forums. Already been addressed. You cannot keep wounding him. So basically you can't somehow have him absorbing. I mean, he doesn't have Guardian, so it wouldn't really work anyway. But for whatever reason, you can't keep shooting IG because he can't just keep taking the wounds. But it's basically if he gets a big, huge die pool thrown against him, he can take it all on the chin, so even if he's 5 over, he'll still survive until the end of the phase, which is amazing, because obviously normally you take him off. So that's really great for if he didn't get a chance to go yet. You don't have to worry about it. Like, he still gets to do something.
It's interesting.
You don't score bounty, because you'll die.
It's interesting that it's not the end of his activation, that it's the end of phase.
Yeah.
Is the thing that I find curious. Like, you know, that took to like you said, make sure he doesn't get bonked off the table before he can activate.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie.
I was going to ask about win conditions.
Yes. Yeah, so
this
say,
is where my brain's going on this. Can you wipe a table?
Intercept score is when.
That's where I was trying to.
The start of the end phase. So you score objectives before the end phase, right? I don't have the flow chart. Sorry. I know there's a chart. I don't have it pulled up in front of me.
I'm actually trying to Google it because literally just popped in my own brain.
Yeah,
I'm trying to look
sorry,
it up right
folks.
Now.
Yeah, we didn't talk about this
before. The RRG.
Before.
Yeah.
I didn't think about this.
Listen to us live.
I don't want to say the wrong thing because it has implications.
But, yeah, I don't want to say the wrong thing either, and I can edit all this.
Well,
all this
okay, we'll come back to that. We'll come back to that. Other thing.
But I do think it may have a thing to do with in win conditions at the end.
Yes. Now,
the other interesting thing from like an organizer standpoint is, I hate to say it, but like judges are going to have to watch IG 88 players a little bit more for like slow play, because for a specifically a dicing down situation, that has huge implications.
That's true.
Oh, yes, it does.
That's true.
It's true. It does.
Not to say that any, if you bring IG 88, like everyone's going to try to slow play with them. I don't think that's the case, but it is something to be aware of.
Sure. Also, something we notice on that card is obviously permanent, duh. Only orders IG 88, but also it is an attack against a unit that is the target of a bounty keyword, not necessarily his bounty. So if you're rolling double bounty, you can kind of prioritize that and have him shoot that bounty token. So it can be quite nice there. While we're working on the flowchart, I like that card a lot, even without, you know, depending on how that works out, even as just, you know, whenever end phase is, it's just nice to be able to make sure that you don't have to worry about him dying. Like, if he's out in the middle of the action, he's still going to get to go. He's going to get to have his say, which is awesome.
Exactly.
Absolutely awesome.
Exactly.
Also big if he's stuck in melee, you know, like, he's still stuck in melee. He's not just going to go away, so they can't just unbubble wrap themselves or whatever by killing him or something like that. So there's definitely some huge implications with that.
Looking at both the end phase keyword and the, like, intercept the transmissions.
Mm-hmm.
Intercept transmission is at the end of the round, so it would be after
the end phase. Okay, that's what I thought. That's what I thought.
The only thing that happens in the end phase is you discard your command cards, you remove all your tokens, you update your order pools, and then you click the round counter over.
Okay.
So I would guess
if you got tabled, if you tabled them, doesn't the game immediately end?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you went for the table, you could win with him still being there.
Sure. You could say
MOV won't matter to you at that point. But
yeah, I don't see, other than like that weird corner case, a huge difference. Like, I see the value in this, but I don't see a huge difference in it saying the end of the end phase versus the end of IG-88's activation. I think the main focus of the card is to make sure on whatever turn he gets destroyed, he gets to activate.
Right.
I think is the big value.
The big value is also that first part of the card where you can just cancel out their tokens. Yeah, yeah. What is that? That's what's the Maul card? Is that Duel of the Fates or Face Me? I don't know, whatever.
Yeah, last?
Sure, whatever. I think it's at last.
Whatever, yeah. But it's at last. But that's permanent. Like, that's every time you shoot that target. Yeah. So you could say, like, look, I'm thinking of a CAD, right? We always talk about all those two dodges on CAD. Screw them. I'm a bounty your CAD, and now I'm hunting your CAD with everything I got with the robot. So it's a great anti-token.
I do love it. I mean,
And then our 2-pip is independent programming, because, hey, he doesn't have programming naturally. This is also permanent.
Nor does he have independent. This card's a lie.
True. So it's a 2-pip. It orders IG-88 and Gardula the Hutt, who's behind him. I don't know if that's who the Hutt is. Let's calm down there. But one of the Hutts. Hutt's confirmed for Legion. There it is. There you go. Also, Dengar confirmed, because Dengar's on the first card. Just saying.
Yes.
I'm waiting. My body is so ready to just be. You know how many years it's been? So
Tim has got three rolls of toilet paper in his closet just waiting for the day Dengar drops.
It has been so many years since playing X-Wing, and we should just say, Dengar! All the time. to the point now where people wouldn't get the joke anymore, but that's okay. Anyway, so IG-88's 2-pip is permanent as well. It is each time IG-88 issues an order to himself, he gets an aim token. He also gains independent dodge. So basically, no matter what, you're getting a token. It's just, do you want an aim or do you want a dodge? If he has a comms relay on him, you get to choose of do you want an aim or dodge.
Yeah, a little bit of Anakin syndrome. And the fact that you're tooling him up with all these permanents.
Yeah.
And so the interesting thing is going to be when list building with 88, you have to like plan the tempo of your command hand.
Yeah.
You don't want to take a bunch of other like fast cards that also want to drop early.
Right. Right.
I honestly could see this like almost being pretty terrifying with like Palpatine, because Palpatine usually wants to hold his cards still pretty late.
Well, because IG-88, I know we'll talk about 11 here in a second, but because IG-88, I would argue, is the longer range version because of Arsenal and things like that. I don't know, maybe. You could just debate that. But 88 or 11, you can pull the strings on and still be in the back line pretty easily.
Sure.
Yeah. So, I can see
that. You drop that 2-pip on turn 1 just to get the things, and then you have the 1-pip for when you really need it.
Yeah.
I mean, I 5 health is not a lot, let's just be honest, but it is behind armor 1 and impervious.
With a red save.
Yeah. With a red die.
Yeah, with a red die. And maybe a dodge token, too, if you want independent dodge.
And yeah.
Sure.
Yep.
Yeah.
And he doesn't, I mean, it should be noted he doesn't get suppression cover because he's a droid trooper, but he also doesn't get suppressed. Right. So.
Yep. Which is nice, yeah. And he's impervious. I always forget the suppression cover thing since I can take exactly like one droid.
Now you can take 2. I always
forget that's a thing. Now I'll soon be able to take 2.
Yeah.
And where these bridges meet, we talked about how 88 and 11 share a 2-pip, which is a pretty terrifying 2-pip, if I say so myself. Both of them are going to give access to a machine made for killing. You nominate one of those 2 droids, and with the token, they get 1 aim token. Demoralize 3 and steady.
That is just horrifying.
That is just terrifying.
I love that. I love that so much.
So, and the crazy part is, if you played IG-88 with the 2-pip that gives him an aim every time he takes an order token to himself, yeah, so that card orders himself. That's 2 aims mm-hmm. and steady. I mean, not and then just demoralize 3. I activate. Oh, it's just gross. You there. You get 1. You get 1. It's just so gross. So
for
gross.
Me, like, Demoralize 3 is cool, but Demoralize 3 there is, like, it's in the wrong place because steady, I imagine, is when you're, like, walking into the thing. Maybe it's your get-out-of-jail card where you're trying to demoralize everybody as you run away and you, move, shoot.
Right.
To get out. But
maybe
yeah,
he's pulling himself in deeper.
That's all about having steady for a turn. And thank God it is IG-88 or IG-11 and not
God,
a band
because
there
good,
are going to be
catch.
Some imperialists that definitely take 2.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, yeah.
Luckily, it is an or. So.
Well, and so that's the thing, too, is I, not to jump ahead, but like I really want to try running both just because it's neat. Like, not even like a new hotness thing, but like just the, it's robots. Like, I just want to,
taking,
just, yeah.
And taking 5 command cards on these 2 operatives seems fun.
Yeah. Yeah, they seem fun. Yeah.
So, we've talked about IG-11 in the past. We've kind of seen his stuff. We've seen his nanny programming, where he gets AI dodge move. We did get his other programming card, which is, is bananas.
Amazing. Amazing.
So good.
This guy, just the only thing we'll review on the unit card is Gunslinger with both range 3 and 4 options. IG-11 gains AI attack, AI aim. And then depending on where you get your bounty, if you put it on a commander unit, all of your weapons gain pierce. Not just against the bounty target, but just all your weapons gain pierce 1.
Yep.
His weapon that already had pierce 1 now stacks at pierce 2, which is insane. And then if you put it on an operative instead, yeah, you get suppressive, which is cool. Yeah, I could see you really
pairing Gunslinger. I can.
With
you Gunslinger range 3 attack. Gunslinger,
and then
pierce
you get
1.
The demoralized card. You can have a big turn of putting a lot of suppression out there. But pierce is pretty good, I've been told.
Yeah, it is.
It is.
So, yeah,
and
it
I know
is.
We talked about like the pierce 2 on that is scary, which I agree. It is very scary, especially with sharpshooter in play. So that's for sure.
Yeah.
But it is still a black and 2 white dice. Right. Now he is not getting as many easy aims as IG-88 is. I'm not saying that he can't get aims, but just that he's not getting them as quite as easily. So I think you're probably looking at 2, and then maybe, I mean, if you're in heavy cover, it's still cover 1. So you're still, I think pierce 1 is probably all that's going to result from those attacks anyway. But I mean, I could be wrong. I mean, you know, dice swing, it's still dice.
If you spike real hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. The other place the pierce, I think, is going to be amazing. It's probably not ideal, but amazing. Is he's got 4 red dice in melee.
For sure.
You're not getting Gunslinger.
Yeah. Yeah.
But 4 red dice on a 110-ish point, base cost unit, and then throwing pierce. And if you're feeling really frisky, you could throw Tenacity on
yes,
there.
Yes, you could.
Make him Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Or I guess he's Anakin.
Not quite.
At that point.
Not quite. Pierce 1. But yeah, yeah.
Yeah. But still, yeah, that's super spooky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then he has two unique command cards. We talked about the shared one. One of them, he loses Gunslinger. And you're like, well, that's silly. Why would I ever want to lose Gunslinger?
It's super Gunslinger.
it's and super basically, Gunslinger. You turn into General Grievous. And you get to make a bunch of attacks. You get to make one attack at each enemy at range 2.
Yes.
And it is not up to range 2. It is at range 2.
And that is, to clarify.
Definitely going
to
have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I was just going to say, that is as it's written on the card. So that's, as far as we know, written correctly. Now, will that get changed? Maybe. But there was a forum discussion recently about that. And it was mentioned that it is at range 2. Now, whether that stays that way forever, who knows? But that is how it is right now. So don't think, like, don't take out your cards and then draw like a 1-2 on there like it was a typo. So as far as we know. That's correct.
Yeah.
Right.
So you're going to have to watch your positioning when you want to drop that card to make sure you get everybody at range 2 and not letting like units that cohere in to get them to range 1. But it's also, yeah, it is when he takes an attack action during it. So it's not like a Grievous that goes after the fact.
No. So you get to kind of rearrange yourself and move to get
the
close
to the one. Yeah, you can maneuver it to where you can, hopefully.
Well, here's the trick is going to be, I think at this point, if you're wanting to take this card, which I do not think is necessarily an auto-include, it probably is, making sure that you've got the tokens and the stuff you need to make that happen, because you're going to have to spend your one action you do get moving where you've got to be.
Right.
To make sure you get all the line of sight and all the proper targets and nobody sneaking into range 1. It's going to be interesting. I like this card because it has a lot of counterplay, which is something I really mm-hmm. appreciate when we see ways for your opponent to have a thing that they can do, but a way for you to be able to interact with it instead of just let it happen to you.
But if that pushes people outside of range 2 from an objective, or sure. even better, into range 1, then so be it.
Yeah.
And honestly, you put that the bounty programming on him, and then you're throwing that range 1-4 weapon at the range 2. That's 2 blacks and a white with a pierce 1 sharpshooter.
Yeah.
Surge's hit. I like it.
That's not bad.
I can't be against it when you're going to attack everything in mechanical carnage.
Yeah.
Love it.
And then he's got another card that lets him blow himself up, which is neat.
It's fine. No big deal.
I think I get flashbacks to the K2SO card that never, ever, ever sees play where you get to blow yourself up. The interesting thing
about
this
card... I've done it
twice
on spiders. Once to great effect, once to no effect.
Yeah.
But that dice pool, though, that's not just... Oh, my God.
It's so good.
Triple red, double black, blast, impact 3, suppressive.
And probably pierce 1 if you did your bounty thing.
Probably pierce 1 if you
yeah,
did your bounty
probably
thing.
Pierce 1.
So God. this one's a little bit better. And the trick is, they're like, you know what? You never play sacrifice, so we're going to make you. If you take IG-11, this has to go into your command hand. It is required.
But you don't have to play it.
Yeah, you don't have to play it.
That'd be amazing if you had to play it. That's kind of cool design space. That'd be interesting.
The other goofy thing is like K2SO's sacrifice is a may ability that you like may remove him.
Right.
This does not have a may. It's if you have so many three or more wounds, it happens. You can't mm-hmm. once you cannot undo what has been put into motion. I foresee a lot of people on the rebel side of things. Lando IG-11 is going to be a thing.
Yes, absolutely.
So you can contingency out of this card if you don't want it. If you don't want to blow yourself up. Because sometimes you do, like, you're in a good position, you have an objective, you're hidden, but you need to give him an order to get him out of a bad spot and run away with a box. And so you're going to be, it gives you an out to where you can play this card and then contingency it away for something else.
So I definitely think if you're going to do the Lando 11, I think you're probably going to pull your Grogu with that one.
Sure.
If you're going to add Grogu, he's going to be in a Lando.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to accidentally blow up your Baby Yoda carrier.
Yes, absolutely.
So that'd be bad. So yeah, I think this character looks really fun. He looks neat. I think he's going to be a. I think both of these are going to be staples in their respective factions. I think Double IG for Empire is going to be a thing that we see.
Yeah, I don't know if it's broken amazing, but again, I just think it's fun. Like it's cool. Like it's neat. I'm excited for it.
They're five wounds. So they're not invincible. They're not Mando saves. They're just regular non-surging saves.
They're impervious, non-surging red saves, but yes.
Yeah, yeah, but you just gotta, you gotta force, theoretically force 10 dice rolls.
Right, they're 50-50, right. Wow, yeah.
Yeah.
In theory. And
armor one, super handy. So, you know, armor one it's got some, it can live, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, not unkillable, but man, they're gonna add some pain train.
They're fun.
Yeah, they are.
Lots of range four options. Yeah. It's gonna be spooky. Tim, as the Empire player, if you could only take one, which do you take?
I think it's a good conversation to have. I think I lean. So thinking of Empire as a whole, right, and how it fits into Empire.
Sure, yeah.
I think I lean 88. Here's my other argument. So Gunslinger's nice for getting those chip shots, for sure.
Sure.
However, I like being able to, I mean, once you get to range 3, of course, being able to throw 3 black, 3 white at surge crit. I just like the idea of that a lot better. Because I feel like with Pierce 1, I feel like you're able to actually clear activations with it, whereas I feel like for 11, you have to wait till they're closer, and for Empire,
yeah,
if they're closer, you're probably in danger, because we don't have a ton of we have decent options nowadays, I guess, with everything else, but again, I think 88 just fits a little bit better.
And I agree, and like you're saying with the chip damage that 11's going to be able to put out,
yeah,
that's not a problem as much for Rebels. Especially, we talked about pairing him with Lando, who's got Sharpshooter 2, Pierce 1.
Right.
So, IG can start something, Lando can finish. We've got Cassian.
For sure.
I feel like we see a lot more Rebels strike teams than we do scouts. Not a ton more. Yeah. But Rebels have lots of chippy options where they can just finish off units that IG starts to bring down. Yeah. I agree with that take for Empire.
And that's, of course, that's
a take. Here's where I'm actually going to differ.
Well, I was just going to say, that's a take saying I've never played either one of them, so I don't know. So anyway, go ahead.
Sure, yeah.
So here's my theory behind this. You put on the five point bounty programming.
Sure. Yeah.
He's worth his weight in gold as 2 sniper units.
Yeah.
Because he's got Gunslinger. And you can do the IG 11. You're rolling 3 dice now, so you're less likely to hit with that black-white, because I know sometimes that black-white die goes terrible in a sniper unit.
You got black-white.
And you're searching to hit.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got the cover sit back. It's not range 5, but you know.
Well, it's not range 5, but it's also not high velocity, so I don't think it replaces snipers.
No, but I see what Ben's saying.
I see what you're saying, but high velocity is, for the Civil War factions, is a big deal.
It is.
Well, and also, I will say, too, maybe for 11... Yeah.
Why not both?
Well, yeah.
But you know, I'm sure that's a thing.
The nice thing, too, with 11, and I'm just kind of thinking out loud, the nice thing, too, for Empire with 11 is that he is also a melee threat with those 4 red, potentially 5 red, if he has tenacity. So he's absolutely a melee threat as well. So maybe you do go with 11. I don't know. I think both are really good.
I don't know. I think they're both fantastic. I really do.
I think either one also pair really well with Bosk, which is fun.
Yes.
Yeah, that's also true.
Or really any bounty hunter. Like, they pair well. I think you can throw, and I think it's nice the way they designed them with not a lot of upgrades or anything. So whereas Mando are so, all the Mandos, whether it's Boba or Din, are so kit heavy, it's really nice to have a unit where you're like, you know what, I got some extra points. If I move this around, I can just throw this IG in there. And he'll probably get some good hits in there. And it's great. Whereas I feel like Mandos, again, either flavor, you really have to think about, which is not to say they're bad, but there's also a beauty to being able to just to plug and play. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like both of them. I like where they're at. I like what they do. I just wish that I could take them.
And you have CAD. You have a really good...
Yeah, so you have probably the best bounty hunter in CAD. You don't play him.
Maybe. I don't know about if that's still true, but yeah, it's He's good.
I've not played the new ones, and I need to. Din, the cards are actually sitting next to me right now. I need
Din
to.
And IG-88 are not out yet, so I'm comparing him against the current roster of bounty hunters.
Well, and Cad Bosk is really good, too. I mean,
yeah, he is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's true.
He is. Well, we have some news. News from the people. This, and I'll be honest, half this news is mostly for me. But, you know, I'm the one who put these episode notes together, so I'm perfectly fine with it. We have a listener who actually messages me quite a bit through the Discord, Sir Matthias von Gergely. He's a local from Ohio, and he's going to actually come play with us down in Cincinnati. He puts together some lists, and so he was at a tournament this past weekend where the guy who won had a list that was very much like Orchimedes' list from a year and a half ago, but using pikes, so an updated version of this list. So I'm going to talk out what the guy had to win with, because I do actually like the list. And then he gave us a change to that list to bring it up to 10 activations. So here's a list. We'll talk about it. We'll come back to it. Pike Syndicate Capo with Vigilance, because if you're going to do it, why not? Kalani, all right, with Vigilance and Improvised Orders. Two Pike Syndicate Foot Soldiers, Disruptor Soldier. Three B2 Super Battle Droids with the HA, the T-Series Tactical Droid, and Emergency Transponders for the times you really need them.
Yep.
Two Magna Guards with RPSs, Situational Awareness, and Tenacity.
I dig it. I mean, and by that I mean I hate it.
That list plays like nothing you play CIS-wise, because you only want to order the Magnas and Kalani. But most of your cards will order Kalani and the Magnus.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's odd. It's interesting. Okay. The only real downside I can see is at $7.97, you only have 9 activations, and a lot of your shots are going to be real heavy at range 2, but 5 units are range 2 guys, and your pikes are going to, I guess, be your range 3s, so you got 2 of them.
So I wonder, too, a little bit, maybe Kalani's because of the direct. Because I do feel like...
It's because of direct, yes.
It's because direct.
This is a little bit more up
close. And strategize.
Well, yeah, but I was... isn't that... What's his face? No, Override. That's right. Kraken has Override.
Yeah,
no. Kraken's got Override. Yeah.
Well, I was just thinking, it seems like a bit more of an in-your-face list, and so I could understand if you wanted to swap out for Kraken to go kind of march up alongside those Magnas. Because he does have a good melee.
I thought that as well, but so apparently the guy who was running it is also named Jay. A lot of Jays out there. it gives you so many tokens. Yeah. Like, you are just dropping tokens left and right, because Magna Guards are getting free ones if they're near their commander. You're going to strategize with Kalani, giving out for lots of free tokens. You're going to pick up lots of surge tokens with the T-Series. The Pikes are going to be dropping things. Improvised Orders, I thought, was a little odd. If only because I thought you were ordering basically everything, I guess, except for your commanders. But I guess in case the one time you draw the Kappa when you really need, one of your core units.
Yes. I think that's
I think you could cut. I think you just cut that upgrade slot. I don't think you really need it, to be perfectly honest. Because it's not a huge bid.
Right.
So, I don't know. Yeah.
So I like it. But he said, look, I wanted to tool this up a little bit. I want to get that 10th activation. So here's the change he made. And I like just kind of walking through it because I don't know if I like it or not. So here's the change he made. Pike Syndicate Capo, Vigilance. Kalani with Underworld Improvised Orders and Vigilance. A Pike Syndicate Foot Soldier with the Electro Whip. Two Pike Syndicates with the Disruptor Boys. Three B2s with the Haas, a T-Series Tactical Droid, and that's it. A BX-Series Sniper. And an IG-100 Magna Guard.
That's a no for me, bro. That's a no for me.
The sniper, I mean, it has deflector shields on it, so it lives longer, I don't think it does you.
But it ain't a Magna.
It gets you 10 activations.
It ain't a Magna.
Cutting Magnas.
I mean, you got an extra pike. You do.
Sure.
It's an Electro Whip, though.
It's an Electro Whip.
We had to take 15 more or 5 more points to get the Underworld Connections.
I think
you could drop the Deflector Shields, because that's like 16 points, to upgrade the Electro Whip boy to a Disruptor boy.
Yeah. I think if you can make this 3 Disruptors, I can maybe see it. But we got to remember that Magnas, at the end of the day, with extra dudes, are 8 red save wounds.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, you're getting an extra activation by getting an extra pike. You're trading basically 8 red save wounds for
six white or two reds and four whites.
Yeah.
Five whites. Yeah.
And that, the magnas are generating surge tokens, so they're kind of like, you know, super red saves. I get what he's going for, and if activation control is something, you know, kind of going back to improv orders, I think of improv orders a lot as like a comfort pick card, where just some people just like to have it. If 10 activations and not playing like 9 acts down at the start of the game is not something you're comfortable with, I can see just having the little extra activation pad is going to be nice. Man, dropping a magna for a whip pike and a sniper.
My other thing is with a whip of any kind, whether that's magna or pike, I really think you need two to make them worthwhile. Because that way
they
can attack at the same time. And you get immobilized too. Now, obviously, you have someone like Cad who can, you know, Cad has immobilized too or whatever on his gauntlets or whatever. But I'm saying for the regular foot soldier dudes or, you know, I guess they're special forces too, but whatever. I think you really need two immobilized to make it worthwhile.
Yeah, I could see that too.
So I'll be honest, my pikes are still sitting in a box to the left of me right here on my desk. I've yet to put them together. I know we get two core units we can pull.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to have an underworld connections for each one additional after that? It's like, he had to go with underworld connections.
Yes.
So he had to go with underworld connections here to get the third pike.
Yes.
Yep. To get a fourth pike, would he have to have another set of allies?
No, it does not stack.
It doesn't stack.
Allies.
So you can have three pikes and that's it.
Right.
Because you also have to have... Well, I mean, you can't take more than that anyway because you need three core and they don't count towards minimums.
Sure. Well, and
then you're at your ceiling.
But yeah, because allies at convenience, it's AOC, not AOC one.
Right. Okay, see, this is the reason I'm asking that question. I've yet to pull them out of the box.
I've
seen people play them, but mostly I've been playing Shadow, and I've just been assuming everyone had the right numbers. So I wasn't paying a ton of attention. Gotcha. I don't know. Yeah, it's interesting.
It's a neat addition. I'd like to see it. I mean, it's still a scary list. I just don't think it's... For the extra activation, you're losing... It's got a little bit less of a bid. It's right at 800. And I will say, I think the difference between a bid of 800 to 799 is bigger than a bid between 799 to 798, if that makes sense. I think there's a lot of people that go to the hilt, and if you can just get a little bit of a bid, I think even a little bit of a bid will get you more ground than a bigger bid of... as the further down you go, the less and less people are bidding. I hardly ever take an 800-point list just because any given tournament I go to, I feel like there's going to be a lot of people who just have 800 points, and then there's going to be people with really steep bids. Sometimes that mid bid can be worth its weight in gold.
Tim, didn't you say you'd played? Well, you did. Like you had the bid four times
with a three or four point bid. Yeah,
I think a six point bid.
Okay.
Yeah. I just remembering it came up in our conversation at some point, so I was like, yeah, I can see that. Final list, Sir Matthias von Gergely has given us. He's like, I want to try to make it look like Shadow Collective, but still in CIS. I was like, okay, cool. What can you do with that? Because again, I have been so much in my rut, I'm always willing to take the stuff here.
Yeah.
Sure.
800 points, 11 activations, which just sounds gross. Pike Syndicate Capo with Vigilance. Yep. T-Series, Tactical Droid with Improvised Orders. Bosk with Hunter and Targeting Scopes.
Mm-hmm.
Maul, Saber Throw, Force Push Tenacity into the fray.
As you do.
Two Pike Syndicate Foot Soldiers with Disruptor Boys. Four B1s with E5Ss, and then the Dark Sith Probe Droids.
I dig it.
Relay.
Yeah, I absolutely dig it.
Correction to myself. I'm sorry. I have a 4-point bid, not 6-point.
Yeah.
Okay.
4-point bid.
Yeah, so, I thought it was, yeah.
Sorry. Yeah.
But that's actually, again, I thank you for the list, man, because I haven't really looked at the way to integrate pikes into my CIS because the CIS does everything I could do anyway. Like, the bag control is such a big deal for them, but there you don't want it, but there you don't have to have it.
Because
the T-Series is going to do what you want to. I'm not even sure I would pull improvised because Bosk and Maul are going to share the same token. The only ones, I guess, would be pikes who don't have it. I mean, I guess you look at two commanders, two... Well, I don't know. Maybe you do need it. For Special Force, you got one of those.
Well,
you've got two sets of agents there. You've got two foot soldiers in the bag. So maybe you do have a messy bag.
Only thing that really worries me about this list is there's no capo. And there's no capos in the Pike Syndicate. They are Courage 1 that panic at 2 that can't draw their leadership to anything.
No. There's a Pike Syndicate.
Oh, there is a capo. Capo. You're right. Yeah, I'm just blind. Yeah, it's fine. All right,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
A plus.
Yeah, like I said, it's interesting, and I appreciate it, and we will try it.
Yeah, that's a solid list, yeah.
Other news, we got a great letter from our buddy Eric in North Carolina.
It's true. We did.
Hello, Stabcast. I'm very sorry to hear that Tim is moving. No one makes me yell at my podcast more than he does, and I need that human-to-human mediated by computers interaction in my life. But I am mostly writing to invite you all to a local tournament here in Durham on November 19th. We're looking to fill out all 32 slots available to us, but it is just a one-day event. Start time is 10:30 at Atomic Empire. Obviously, I totally understand if y'all don't end up coming for the event, as I'm sure you get invites to tons of tournaments. Sure we do. Sure.
We're so popular.
Sure, yeah, sure, sure, buddy. Yeah, we're just But I will say we've got a spicy crowd in terms of ranked players over here with Kentucky Dan. I remember him. Richard Laverly.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I also remember him.
He was the man that tabled me at Nova first.
This is why I gave you this email to
Michael Cohen. Along with a great group of solidly competitive folks like me coming in hot at 163. Also, Zodiac came to our last tournament at Atomic, just burying that lead, but that's fine. But
yeah.
Atomic. So you we're know, going to try and get him there. Up here again. We have a fantastic judge in Matt England to run the show, and you have plenty of friends or friends by association to potentially help with lodging if you so desire. Keep up the great work.
Ooh, that sounds like a sleepover invite.
If it wasn't Hell for yeah. Andor, the newest episode of Stabcast would be the highlight of my Wednesdays. Now, see, that's good priorities, though. Like, don't.
It is. That's fair.
Yeah, if you're listening to us instead of Solid. Watching Andor, get your priorities straight. Like, what are you? What are you doing? Come on. Look at all the new units we're getting from Andor one day.
That's like, one day, baby. Yeah.
One day, I will have the corpo authority. I don't know what role they're going to fill, for sure. Crying corpo
mercenary?
Bootlicker. This man. There it is. Yes.
Oh, this is the podcast is not the place to have this conversation. We'll do it.
You're right.
Yes. Man, yeah, I will. Had some thoughts about those first two episodes.
Yes.
had some thoughts. So I will go add this event over to our list for next episode. But I didn't want to spoil it by having it up top and then blood it down the bottom. But we do love Eric. We do. Durham is right outside that six-hour line for us. But
see what we can make happen.
Love the idea of it. Absolutely. Absolutely.
I won't be able
those
to
are great
there.
People honestly
I won't be I mean, there
okay oh, you're now way too far
yeah, well, you're
you see
York,
Richard so Laverly has managed. Defeated me so hard that I have run all the way up
there. State.
I had to leave,
but it is also a fantastic group of people and they do play absolutely hard.
Yeah,
I mean, yeah, they'll bring the good competition. So man, we get more places holding 32 person tournaments, that would also be mm-hmm. lovely.
Yeah, that'd be huge.
I really, huge. I'm still just stuck on the, you got a lot of invites. Who do you think we are? Because we're not the who you think we are. We're the,
we talk on the internet, we're important.
we do actually get a lot of invites. We just don't have the ability, nor the money, or the time to get there.
Ben mostly ignores them, and then Will falls asleep on them. True. And then so Ryan and I have to go places. Ryan now has the South, I have the North Quadrant, so you know, it's fine.
Listen, I will have gone to a tournament in Cincy. I will have gone to one there, Rocky Top. I went to one at Cherokee this year. Yeah.
Okay.
So
that's
going
not a bad
in,
place for me to be.
Going
place
into
me.
The year, I thought I was going to be the one that just like only plays Tournament Legion and doesn't go engage with the rabble of the rabble, local rabble. Game group. And it turns out that was Ben all along.
That was me. That was actually me the entire time. Like I said, we've got to get back. I got to get back out to the game store more. Now that Tim is gone, I don't have any. We don't.
Yeah, you guys got to get out there now. That's on you.
That's exactly it. Tim was our local. Our local.
Now, hold on. Ryan's a Wednesday in a month and a half.
Yeah, Ryan's been coming out consistently now. Yeah.
That's true.
I'll give him that. Maybe not for the past 2 years like I have been, but that's fine. You know, it's okay.
Yeah. Well, I started showing back up. I took my lease back and kicked you out to New York.
That's right. That's right. That's right. And New York will
so, as always, guys.
Yeah. No, they won't. They'll meet you and they'll be like, oh, screw this guy.
That's fair.
So, Tim, you just got to develop Stabcast North so hard that we start taking away. I mean, I love that we have infiltrated you into 5th Trooper territory, like physical territory.
Yeah, yes. Physical territory.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah.
And just start. Listen, start slapping those stickers, man. We knew you took some up there with you. Just start slapping those stickers on people's boxes.
I fully plan to go into Jay's house. I know he's not far from here. I'm gonna go into his home. And you think I'm not just gonna randomly vandalize something with a Stabcast sticker? Like, but it's gonna be real subtle, like underneath his keyboard or something. Like he's not gonna see it till like 3 years from now when we're all retired and we've given up on everything. And yeah, it's gonna be underneath that. Maybe like, oh, I don't know. I've never met his kids before. Maybe I'll give one to his kids. Like, hey, stick this on something daddy loves. Like, you know, dude.
No. We're going to make you really small ones, Tim, so you can put it on the back of his family photos. Like, you're just going to lift up the frame and, like, tuck.
I'm going to put it underneath the toilet seat. Hey, I have to use the bathroom real quick.
No, we can't do it there because that's where we belong.
Oh, that's fair.
The whole point of this operation is to go places we don't belong. That's
fair. I love this plan so very much. Just so very much.
And then I'll freak him out. I'll put other people's stickers around too. So it's like, who's been in my house? How many people are breaking into my home?
So, as great members of espionage that we truly are, we probably shouldn't discuss this on the air, our evil nefarious plans to be put out to other people. So I think it's time to end the show.
Yes.
So, as always, everybody, thanks for hanging out with us on your drive time, your paint time, whatever it is time that you bother to listen to this nonsense ramble. Until next time, I'm Ryan Slowski, reminding you that independence still frustrating. I don't know. Bikes are stupid. Will's dice rolls are broken.
It's Will's dice roll. It's Will's wrist. Just break his wrist, Ryan. Just break his wrist. All right.
Done and done. Why do you think he couldn't be here today?
That's right. I'm Tim Haddon, reminding you that, you know what? Sometimes the digital dice roller is just as bad as the fancy wrist rolling. So it happens. It happens.
And I'm Ben Fowler reminding you, no matter where you play the Legion, at least you're playing the Legion, which is something that I could say this week. So
This week.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Or good morning.
I definitely have another episode of Legion Play, because remember? Because I got one come up this weekend.
What if you
two episodes in a row? Yeah, it's two for two, baby.
Okay, Grandpa, let's get you back into the home.
In my day, we only had two factions. Okay. And we liked it that way.
Our snipers will range infinity. Okay, Grandpa, okay.
Pikes, we never heard of them. We'd never seen one, actually. And I'm stopping the episode.